let's see two more examples based on Coulomb's law, and these are interesting questions. Question 2, which says 2 point charges plus 3 microcoulomb plus 7 microcoulomb repel each other with force of 21 newton. If each charge is given plus minus 5 microcoulomb charge additional charge, what will be the force? Okay, so solution here, look at solution here. For first equation you can make k q1 q2 over r square. For second case you can write k q1 dash q2 dash over r square. There will be a difference only in the charges because you are giving additional charge to each charge, isn't it? Apart from that, there will be no major difference. So divide F2 by F1 is equal to what? Q1 dash Q2 dash over Q1 Q2. Equation 3. I'm solving this question, right? Now, put the value Q1 dash. This is obtained after adding charge. So, plus 3 coulomb plus minus 5 microcoulomb. So, F2 over F1 is equal to, this will be minus 2 microcoulomb into 2 microcoulomb. Earlier 3 into 7 microcoulomb, fine. So microcoulomb cancelled, you will have minus 4 by 21. F2 is equal to minus 4 by 21 into 21, because F1 is given 21, minus 4 newton. So the force between 2 point charges will be 4 newton. And this minus sign shows that there will be an attraction. Obviously, one is positive, another is negative. So, there will be a force of attraction. Now, have a look on question number 2. A charge Q is placed at the center of two identical charges, capital Q. So, I say one capital Q here, another capital Q here. Center charge is Q. So, this is RY2. This is R. When we say system is in equilibrium, it means the force acting between any two point charges must be zero, right? So first I calculate between this. So it is 1 over 4 pi epsilon naught between Q and Q. Q square over R square. This force also should be equal to force between small q and capital Q, epsilon naught q into q over r by 2 whole square. So you see, this cancels, this r square cancels, 1 q cancels, what is left? Q equals to 4 q. So plus equals to 0, plus q 4q equals to 0, so q is equal to minus 4. Total sum of the forces would be 0. That's what is the equilibrium position. Let's take one more example, very interesting example, and then bind up this Coulomb's law. Rest of the questions you can do by yourself. You can also look, have a look on NCERT solved example, doesn't matter. Let's take 2 point charges Q and Q are suspended with the help of a string of length L. Q charges, masses are M, separated by distance x apart. Each string makes an angle theta. If this system is in equilibrium, then calculate and derive a relation for Q. So in short, if the system is in equilibrium, find expression for Q. Now see, there will be a tension in this string. Yes, tension T, resolve this into two components, T cos theta, T sin theta, mg acting down. So how many forces are acting? And there will be a force of repulsion. So T sin theta is actually counterbalanced by Coulombian force, 1 over 4 pi epsilon naught Q square over x square. P cos theta is equal to mg dividing 1 by 2. Tan theta is equal to Q square over 4 pi epsilon naught x square mg. Fine. So Q square is equal to 4 pi epsilon naught x square mg tan theta. This is a relation. Simple. But if in the question, suppose x is also not given, then you have to assume x. If x is not given, I am expanding this question. If x is not given, then you use any right angle triangle. This is theta, this is L, this is XY2. Opposite side of an angle is perpendicular, so x by 2L is equal to sin theta. This implies x is equal to 2L sin theta. So put up this value here. In place of x, you will get answer. More elaborated answer. Q is equal to 4 pi epsilon naught. X square is 4L square. Right? Sin square theta. Mg. Tan theta. And square root of this. So you can write 4L sin theta is square root of pi epsilon naught mg tan theta. What we have done, just put up the value of x there. 2L sin theta, so 4L square sin square theta. Is that clear? That's how you can do NCERT questions also. NCERT question numbers or short exercises you can check. Let's see short exercises number. NCERT 1.5, 1.6 and 1.7. Now we will see principle of superposition of force. What is principle of superposition? This principle is applied when multiple charges are kept, and because of the multiple charges we have to calculate force on a single charge. Then principle of superposition states that the total force acting on a given point charge due to a system of point charges is equal to the vector sum of the forces exerted by each individual charge on a point charge. I have written here, say for example, there are n point charges Q1, Q2, Q3, Qn having position vector R1, position vector R2, position vector R3 and position vector Rn. At origin I kept charge Q0. So how do we calculate net force? First calculate between force between Q1 and Q0, then Q2 Q0, Q3 Q0, Qn Q0 finally, and take a vector sum. So we can write it F0 is equal to force between Q1, that is K, Q1, Q0, R1 square, R1 cap, K, Q2, Q0, R2 square, R2 cap, K, Qn, Q0, Rn square, R0 cap, Rn cap, right? Now you can sum up. K is 1 over 4 pi epsilon naught. Q0 is also common. Rest you can bring in the summation. I is equal to 1 to n Qi Ri square Ri cap. This is how you can calculate your net force. But is it so easy to apply in case of the numerical problems as it looks like theoretically? Let us check. Take an example. I take a simple example first. That is case of the more than 2 point charges. Suppose there is an equilateral triangle. Example 1. And 3 charges are kept at the corner of an equilateral triangle, each of side L. And question says, calculate net force at A. This is A, this is B, this is C. So this charge will exert force on this A, FA, FB. Force exerted by charge kept at C is FC. This angle is 60, this angle is also 60 degree. So how to solve? Force FB and FC you will calculate by Coulomb's law. FB mod is equal to K Q into Q over L square. FC also you can calculate as mod K Q into Q over L square. These forces are coming identical. Now these two forces are inclined at what angle? 60 degree. Yes? Means what? If two forces are inclined at an angle of 60 degree, then what we are supposed to do? We have to apply law of parallelogram. So use law of parallelogram. Now you have to apply law of parallelogram. That is, net force equals to square root of this, mod of FB whole square plus mod of FC whole square plus 2 mod of FB mod of FC cos 60. FB is equal to FC. So if I say mod of FB is equal to mod of FC is equal to X, let. So you can easily solve now. Then net force magnitude is equal to FB X square plus X square plus 2X square cos 60 is 1 by 2. So this cancels, is square root. So X root 3 is answer. You can put the value K Q square root 3 over L square. That's how you have got magnitude. But if you have to calculate direction of this force, then again you have to use tan alpha is equal to mod of B sin theta over mod of A plus mod of B cos theta. So choose any force, base force, and then calculate angle between them. Fine. Angle of the resultant. Resultant will come out where? Somewhere here. Make a parallelogram. This is the result. Net force is here. Similarly, if four point charges are placed on the square, side of the square, say like this, example 2, four point charges are placed on the square, Q, 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 side is A, B, C, D, and you are asked to calculate force acting on charge Q. So one force is this, Fc, another force is exerted by Fa, third force is exerted by Fd. Now this becomes a question of three forces. So since in case of the square, normally this angle is 45 degrees, so it is easy to work it out. Otherwise, what you have to do, these forces will also come out same. So one first method you can do, use Pythagoras for Fa and Fc. So when you use Pythagoras, then F dash is equal to Fa square plus Fc square, and Fa and Fc are same, right? And then F dash will be in the direction of Fd. Fd. So net force F is equal to F dash plus Fd. Fd. How do we calculate Fa and Fc? Same procedure, Coulomb's law, K, Q1, Q2 over R square. But if it is, Fa is not equal to Fc, if Fa is not equal to Fc, then this resultant will be along direction of Fd. Then what you do? Resolve Fd into two components. Here you will have say theta here, then Fd cos theta this side, Fd sin theta this side. This side already you have Fc, this side already you have Fp. So this figure reduces to finally two forces, Fa plus F cos theta. This side will be Fc plus Fd sin theta. Now these two forces are inclined at an angle of 90 degree. So you can use Pythagoras. Now use Pythagoras for these two forces. So final net force magnitude will be Fa plus F cos theta whole square plus Fc plus Fd sin theta, Fd sin theta whole square, and square root of this. Fine. So if you know the value of say Fa, Fd cos theta and Fd sin theta, this value comes out, whatever in numerical it may might change x, this is y, so you can say x square plus y square square. So remember, in case of the square, since diagonal and these two forces are same, the resultant of Fa and Fc lies along Fd, so you can straightway add. But Fa is not equal to Fc, then resultant of Fa and Fc will not lie along Fd. In that case, you have to resolve force Fd in two components, sine component and sine cosine component, and then finally use Pythagoras. Let's see now continuous distribution of charges. Continuous distribution of charges. Charges can be distributed continuously in three ways. Number one is line charge distribution or linear charge distribution. Right? In this distribution, point charges are continuously distributed along a line segment. Suppose Q charge is distributed over a line segment of length L. So we need, or you can say, a continuous distribution of point charges along a line is termed as linear charge distribution. For defining it, we need a physical quantity termed as line charge density. Lambda. And it is defined as amount of charge confined over unit length. So lambda is equal to Q over L. Simple algebraic expression. For differential form, I assume a small line segment of length dl, charge dq, then lambda is equal to dq over dl. Similarly, second method is surface charge distribution. When point charges are continuously distributed over a surface of a certain area, I say Q amount of charge distributed over surface area S. So when point charges are continuously distributed over a given surface area, we call it as surface charge distribution. To calculate this type of distribution, we have a physical quantity called surface charge density. Definition goes parallel. Amount of charge confined over unit surface area. So sigma is equal to Q over S. Differential form. And differential form, you can write sigma is equal to small q here. Why small q I made? Because already we have assumed a small q charge distributed over entire surface. So if you want to calculate, suppose if you want to calculate total charge and when linear charge density is given, then dq is equal to lambda into dl, and total charge is integration of dq dl lambda dl integration L, linear integration. From here, when you want to calculate total charge, suppose sigma is given and you are asked to calculate total charge, q is equal to integration of dq integration of sigma ds. This is surface integration. Third type of distribution is volume charge distribution. What is volume charge distribution? In the same manner we go, then volume charge distribution is again continuous distribution of point charges in all three directions. So this is a cube which is filled with charges. Assuming Q amount of charge is filled in this and volume is V, and in a small volume section dV, charge amount is dQ. So what is volume charge distribution? I repeat again, the continuous distribution of point charges over a given volume is termed as volume charge distribution. Like others, we also have a physical quantity to measure it called volume charge density. Rho, and rho is equal to total charge per unit volume. Fine. Therefore, differential form, you can write rho is equal to dQ over dV. In the same manner, if rho is given and you are asked to calculate total charge, then total charge Q is integration of dQ, integration of rho dV. This is volume integration. So first, linear charge distribution is basically one dimensional distribution of charges, and it involves line integration. Surface charge integration is basically two dimensional distribution of charges, and it involves surface integration when you want to calculate the magnitude of total charge and surface charge density is given. In volume charge distribution, you have to use volume integration to calculate total charge, and it is three-dimensional distribution of point charges.